Good afternoon. Welcome to the third talk in our fall lunchtime lecture series. This season, we're focusing on the history of the physical and life sciences and their intersections with issues of colonialism, race, and gender. I'm Charlotte Abney Solomon, Assistant Director of the Center for Historical Research at the Science History Institute. It's my honor today to introduce our speaker, Alan Driggers, Assistant Professor of History at Tennessee Tech University. Before I introduce Alan, I'll say a bit about the format of today's lecture. Alan will speak for about 40 minutes, after which we'll have 20 minutes for audience Q&A. You can send in your questions during the talk using the chat function here on YouTube. You'll just need to log in and we'll collect the questions from the chat for the Q&A. You can also email us your questions at lunchtimelectures@sciencehistory.org. We do have a two-step spam filter, so if you're emailing us for the first time, you may need to watch your inbox and reply to a verification email. But we will be happy to have your questions. That's at lunchtimelectures@sciencehistory.org. Now, I'd like to introduce today's speaker. Alan Driggers is a historian of science, technology, and medicine in the 19th century. He's currently at work on two books. One is titled No Stone Unturned, Chemistry and the Republic of Medicine. And the other is Gender and Geology, Women, Communities, and Oil Exploration. Alan was an Edelstein Fellow here at the Science History Institute back in 2014-2015. We're very happy to welcome him back today, if virtually, to speak about the botanical work of a 19th century physician during the American Civil War. Thank you for being with us today, Alan. The floor is yours.
Hi, I'm Alan Driggers, and I am an associate professor of history at Tennessee Technological University. And I am so honored and happy to be here to give my brown bag talk. I haven't given a brown bag talk since it was the Chemical Heritage Foundation. I was a fellow here a couple of years ago while I was finishing my dissertation, and it was such a wonderful and fantastic place filled with so many caring and wonderful staff that really made the difference in my career trajectory and helped me really get some good publications out. And it was just such an affirming place. And I'm excited to see how it's changed and stuff. And I'm also excited to talk to you guys. I'm located in Cookeville, Tennessee, which is about halfway between Nashville and Knoxville. And I'm currently on my aunt-in-law's front porch. She's definitely decorated for fall, as you see the cat and stuff here, sitting outside talking about botany, which I think is so utterly perfect. So I hope everybody's getting some outside time. I know it might be a little cooler, in the north as opposed to the southern area, but it's nice that fall's here, and it's nice to be able to encounter everything that pumpkin spice can be basically put into. So I'm gonna share my paper, and then I'll be excited to hear kind of questions and stuff. I'm trying to move this paper to a publication. My original work was about the history of urinary stones, so this was a bit of a departure for a second project, but something that I just kind of couldn't help be interested in because of, the need now too to spend a lot of time outside. And, kind of once you have something, kind of life-changing like this pandemic kind of going on, it seems that it causes you to, you can't help but to look at life and kind of a different direction and stuff. So I kind of noticed the kind of history of plants and stuff. So this is an attempt to kind of think about plants and what a kind of useful kind of narrative framework that might be. So the name of the paper is The Resources of the Southern Fields and Forests, Botany and the American Civil War, and the Limits of Regional Analysis. And so I'm going to focus on Francis Peyrie Porcher in this case study in order to kind of get at, well, how are plants, in the 19th century, how can they best be viewed in terms of, is a regional framework all that helpful? It's helpful in other aspects of historical analysis, but does it kind of hide the kind of opportunism that somebody like Porsche, engaged in and stuff. He kind of like reformatted his work to fit kind of the needs of the time. And once the pandemic is over, or, if you can kind of get around and stuff, you can go to Charleston, South Carolina, and there is kind of a reproduction of his medicinal garden and stuff. So again, I encourage you to, you know, check out Charleston and hit that. So during his life, Francis Peyrie Porsche continuously worked on a volume about the botanical plants of the South. Porsche believed his study to be non-regional and a source that potentially any American or European could use. Porsche hoped to augment the growing knowledge of Materia Medica at the time. At the time of the publication of his articles and two editions of his books, physicians were trying to wrestle botanical knowledge away from, you know, irregular practitioners and engage in a symptomatic way of knowing how to use plants to fight diseases, illnesses, and injuries. However, the story of the emergence of medical botany in America has only incorporated Porsche's contribution in terms of the looming American Civil War. Scholars usually subsume Porsche's work into a nationalistic framework or simply construct its meaning in regards to regional actors. But by seeing beyond this nationalistic and regional framework, Porsche's 1863 and 1869 editions of the Resources of the Southern Fields and Forests reveal the author's thoughts about medicine, materia medica, and the role of physicians in knowing plant remedies. Porsche entered the American Civil War as a physician, but got leave of his duties attending wounded soldiers in both the field and in the hospital, so that he could write about medical resources available in the South. The Surgeon General of the Confederacy, Samuel Preston Moore, encouraged Porsche's ideas about the value of the South's botanical resources. Porsche first published these ideas in the August 1861 edition of DeBow's Review. In DeBow's Review, Porsche argues that the South had many resources that would be economically beneficial. In 1863, during the turmoil of the Civil War, Porsche published Resources of the Southern Fields and Forests, which was described as, quote, a medical, economical, and agricultural book, being also a medical botany of the Confederate States, end quote. While a number of historians have examined Porsche's role during the Civil War, there should be studies of Porsche's work both before and after the war. Though he is a Southerner and later a Confederate sympathizer, Porsche cites Northern sources and authorities about plants in the South alongside European sources. Porsche's work does not fit into an explicitly Southern or Confederate nationalistic context. In this paper, I argue that Porsche's work is neither the exclusionist Southern narrative, but a narrative that migrates between regional and national discussions of the potential use of Southern plants for medical needs. Porsche's intellectual work before, during, and after the American Civil War does not completely fit in with existing regional models of analysis. If the Confederate nationalism that surrounds other interpretation of Porsche's work is reframed, Resources of the Southern Fields and Forests is, in a larger context, basically medical and scientific content. In both the 1863 and 1869 editions of the Resources of the Southern Fields and Forests, Porsche used the same mode that he used when he wrote medical tracts about indigenous plants for the national audience of the American Medical Association almost 20 years before the eve of the Civil War. The Resources of the Southern Fields and Forests and a, quote, sketch of the medical botany of the state of South Carolina that he also wrote that appeared in the Transactions of the American Medical Association, the second volume in 1849, look very similar, independent of the regional context. Though Porsche occasionally includes small allusions to Southern distinctiveness, his writing is devoid of the ultra-Confederate nationalism that other scholars have examined in other pieces of work. The 1869 edition needs to be contextualized perhaps even beyond the 1863 edition. Scholars like Leslie Butler point out that, quote, during Reconstruction, persistent dilemmas of sectional distinctiveness, science and region, self and society, national consolidation, liberalism, and America's place in the world began to assume a recognizably modern form, end quote. Butler also notes that Reconstruction in the South has room for more examination beyond simple regional themes. However, Butler argues that there are still larger sectional themes that remain in Reconstruction. Porcher's Resources of the Southern Fields and Forests is more reflective of the previous medical works that Porcher was writing prior to the Civil War than that of the new political regime of the South during the 1863 and even in 1869. I will argue in this paper that both the 1863 and the 1869 editions reflect Porcher's different intellectual projects. However, each of these two projects involved Porcher's primary goals of making physicians aware of medical botany and increasing their knowledge of the materia medica. And the materia medica is basically kind of like the medical uses of plants. For instance, Peyre Porcher's life spanned both the pre- and the post-war period in American history. Porcher, born on December 14, 1825 in Berkeley County, South Carolina, studied at the South Carolina College in 1844. The historian of South Carolina medicine, Joseph Iyer Waring, describes the esteemed pedigree of Porcher in the second volume of his History of Medicine in South Carolina. Porcher received a robust early education at the Mount Zion Institute. He received his medical doctorate from the Medical College of South Carolina in Charleston in 1847. His dissertation, quote, A Medical Botanical Catalog of the Plants and Ferns of St. John's, Berkeley, South Carolina, end quote, shows Porcher's early interest in bringing botanical knowledge to physicians. After his medical education, Porcher spent time traveling across Europe, continuing his medical education. When he returned to South Carolina, he completed apprenticeships as he opened a hospital for slaves. Prior to the Civil War, Porcher published other works on medical botany. One of these works include, quote, Sketch of the Medical Botany of South Carolina, end quote. The thesis was later published in Charleston in 1847. In his published dissertation, he speaks of his desire to focus botany to the utility of medicine, unlike the general surveys of previous botanical surveys of North America. Porcher writes that, quote, We have endeavored to ally this one more closely to medicine and render it not without interest to physicians generally by inserting numerous references to works which contain desirable information concerning those possessing medicinal or useful qualities. There is also an optimism expressed in Porcher's dissertation that he is also continually reflected in his work over his lifetime, that in nature, there is everything necessary to improve health. He writes that, quote, It has also convinced us of the truth of the assertion that we have every means for the preservation and restoration of health in the indigenous varieties so remarkably abundant in the lower portions of South Carolina, end quote. He was also interested in working with the microscope prior to the Civil War. He published some of his findings in, quote, Illustrations of Disease with the Microscope, Clinical Investigations in 1860. The South Carolina Medical Association gave Porcher an award for his original work. Porcher practiced medicine in Charleston prior to the Civil War. From biographical sources, Porcher seemed to have practiced both aspects of medicine and surgery, especially when he was working at the Marine Hospital there. When the Civil War started, Porcher's work in the hospitals in Norfolk, he worked in the hospitals in Norfolk and Petersburg, Virginia. After the Confederacy was defeated, Porcher returned back to civilian medicine, where he was elected president of the South Carolina Medical Association and eventually was elected to the College of Physicians of Philadelphia. He was active in the broader medical community, publishing in the Charleston Medical Review from 1850 to 1855 and from 1873 to 1876. After the Civil War, Porcher remarried after the death of his first wife in 1866 and had four children with Margaret Ward in 1876. Porsche passed away in 1895. So let's look at the 1863 version of the Resources of the Southern Fields and Forests. Many pieces of scientific work produced by natural philosophers and natural historians who align with the Confederacy contain Confederate nationalism. Porsche even makes periodic asides to the providential nature of the Confederacy. However, when Porsche's work is viewed outside of a regional lens, it is not unlike his previous medical and scientific work. Porsche repackages the material for new and changing audiences. Porsche readily cites Northern and European sources that explain the use of plants that appear in the South. For example, the entry in Resources of Fields and Forests for Lycopis virginensis, which was collected in the Charleston and Richland districts, as well as out of Florida. Porsche notes that according to Dr. Ives of New Haven, it is a mild narcotic. Doctors Pendleton and Rogers of New York obtained favorable effects from its incipient pithis and hemorrhage from the lungs, end quote. In fact, Porsche cites no Southern authority for its proper use. He only notes that, quote, this plant grows abundantly in the lower country of South Carolina, end quote. Porsche's Resources of Southern Fields and Forests, Medical, Economical, and Agricultural, completed in 1863, was published in Charleston. The Surgeon General of the Confederacy, S.P. Moore, returned Porsche to South Carolina from the battlefield in order to complete this writing assignment. Prior to the war, Porsche had actively written lengthy works for the uses of plants for medical purposes. Arguably, Resources of the Southern Fields was Porsche's most well-known and possibly his masterpiece. Historians and lay readers alike assume that Confederate nationalism and the Civil War were key to the book's construction. These assumptions about the nature of the work are mistaken. The book was picked up by scientific publications, both nationally and internationally, not only regionally, and it received positive press. To understand the context of this work, it will be useful to explore sampling of some of the reviews of the work. Porsche was explicit about his purpose in writing Resources of the Southern Fields. In his preface to his book, he explains that his work was prepared by the Surgeon General's request. Porsche stated that the book was, quote, intended as a repertory of scientific and popular knowledge as regards to medical, economical, and useful properties of the trees, plants, and shrubs found within the limits of the Confederate States. Whether employed in the arts, for manufacturing purposes, or in domestic economy to supply a present as well as future want. This medical repertory is collected in order to find good substitutes for foreign articles of vegetable origin that will be valuable to both the physician and the planter. Porsche did not think of a future world devoid of planter estates. Nonetheless, he viewed his work as valuable to the medical and farming interests of all types because they would no longer have to import costly medications to the South. Porsche allows that so many of the economic and non-medical information are not useful in the strictly medical world, but because of the exigency caused by the work. Porsche includes economic uses of plants, for instance, instructions for making soap, oils, charcoal, and other economic needs for plants are included in the Resources of the Southern Fields and Forests. Prior to and during the Civil War, Porsche was in constant communication with his field officer, William Gilmore Sims. Sims was a popular writer of Porsche's time, and Sims was recognized fondly for his literary talent both in the North and the South. But again, there were when you view Sims's work in a war, you know, in kind of present context and stuff, it still provides the kind of disturbing racialized kind of language and stuff that you would expect to read in the 19th century. Sims contributed botanical entries and offered suggestions to Porsche, and even reviewed the book in a letter dated April 14, 1863, Sim agrees with another well-known naturalist, Henry William Ravenel, that Porsche's 1863 work is of, quote, a wonderful industry and great variety of resources and should prove an exhaustive mine of information, not only to the scientific, but to the great body of our people. Sims meant the Southern people, but he did understand its relevance to a, also to a wider scientific audience. However, Sims's biting criticism is the book is of, quote, popular character, end quote, but does not have the correct size to be useful to the, quote, plain housekeeper, end quote. Sims mostly criticizes the high amount of citations found in Porcher's work. Specifically, Sims is worried that the formality of science is diminishing the practical usefulness of Porcher's work. Tilting at the formality of science, Sims states, quote, I am aware that there is a large class of grave blockheads in the world for whom you can only make approach of being clad in the armor of authority, who are only to be overhauled by the solemn externals of science, who listen to you if you speak in a dead language, but turn a deaf ear when you wag the modest vernacular, end quote. Sims also discusses chocolate cakes that, quote, Yankee merchants, end quote, made out of ground nuts that taste like chocolate. In his letter, Sims has an envious view of botanical industry in the North, which could have appeared in the South. Sims also cautions Porcher about the, quote, omissions, end quote, concerning poke, end quote, or appleweed, end quote. Dr. Edward North has heard from slaves that this weed is not a poisonous or commonly thought. In his letter, Sims cautions Porcher about using botanical books and says, quote, and though the books still continue to denounce it as poisonous, we're going to insert bracket here, slaves in bracket, still as I believe, for I have not inquire lately, continue to use it without feeling their intestines any worse to wear, end quote. Sims suggests that Porcher should further investigate the Mayweed. In 1847, the American Medical Association appointed a committee to investigate, quote, the composition and medical qualities of indigenous remedies, end quote. The committee was responsible for essentially surveying all the plants in American botanical literature and estimated that there were over 1,000 plants that appeared medically promising. The justification of the study of botanical plants bolstered the reputation of physicians in the area of Materia Medica. Physicians seemed not to have had the sophisticated knowledge of Materia Medica that apothecaries or even, quote, swamp doctors, end quote, had at their disposal. The tradition of sending patients out for prescriptions left the physician in a strange position. He was not handling any medicines. Though the committee noted that an apothecary handling the prescriptive discharge was not in a terrible state of affairs, it would nonetheless benefit the physician to have more knowledge of Materia Medica. Physicians like Porcher attempted to move closer to Materia Medica by experimenting with indigenous plants. The introduction of the committee's report highlighted Francis Peyrie Porcher's experiments. Porcher determined that the Sarsenia, or saddle flower, is only found in the bogs of North America, making it difficult to obtain. The flower ranges from the Hudson's Bay to Florida. The only thorough medical analysis of the Sarsenia was performed by Porcher as, quote, learned, end quote, and a quote-unquote industrious member of the Commerce Committee from South Carolina. The committee claimed that they were indebted to Porcher because he determined that, quote, the root of the plant or the portion of the stem below the surface of the ground is in part used from, quote, the foregoing examination. It may be inferred that besides lingering coloring matter and traces from the resinous body, it contains an acidic salt of lime. The acid being neither the tannic nor the garlic, but possibly one altogether new, and that a salt of some alkaloid, perhaps related to Jesuit's bark, which, should it prove new, may be called the Sarsenia. Porcher also determined that, quote, the bitter and, quote, stringent qualities of the root were imperfectly extracted by water, end quote. The committee also noted that Porcher found that the plant was more destitute of the bitter and astringent qualities that were put into cold infusion. Porcher further determined that the plant held a considerable amount of starch, and upon testing a slice of the root, found that the plant was very acidic. Porsche then ingested some of the plant by drying it and manufacturing it into pills. Porsche published the information in the Charleston Medical Review, published in 1849. After ingesting the plant, Porsche determined that the plant was a pungitive diuretic. The committee and Porsche seem to embrace history, especially botanical history. Porsche points out that the Sarracenia was used in South Carolina by early settlers in the parish of St. James Santee. Historically, Porsche says that Sarracenia was a useful remedy for dyspepsia, sick headache, etc. The committee highlights Porsche's article in the Charleston Medical Review and Journal, and there are several cases of dyspepsia, quote, relieved, end quote, by chewing on the root of Sarracenia or ingesting the plant through a tincture with the metal. When the actual source of the committee's report is examined, a fuller story more emerges. Porsche noted that he not only knew of curative properties of the Sarracenia from the historical use, but also highlighted the widespread publication of knowledge of the Sarracenia medical benefits from Dr. James McBride of South Carolina, who published an article about the same plant in the Transactions of the Linnaean Society of London. Porsche also points out that he had learned from his medical application, quote, through a gentleman of great respectability, end quote, who heard it from a woman in a neighborhood in which he lived. One of the relatives became sick and suffered from dyspepsia, but also, quote, sick headache with anorexia, lassitude, and prostration of muscular strength. The female relative recovered, and the gentleman noted that ingesting Sarracenia restored the tone of his stomach. The gentleman even chewed Sarracenia instead of chewing tobacco. Porsche further highlights that the gentleman's brother was also a physician who vouched for the efficacy of the drug. Porsche, of course, shares the cases of those only of his status. The South Carolina committee in the working in the American Medical Association was under the direction of Porsche, and it arranged the plants of the state into classes based on the Lindley natural system. Porsche organized his presentation this way because it demonstrates both the natural history and the medical utility of each plant. Porsche then organized his plants by natural orders. In his report, Porsche mentioned that sanguinaria Canadensis, also known as a blood root of the poppy tribe, fell in a category that usually refers to narcotics. He noted that the plant was found in Charleston, Abbeville, Richland, and Fairfield districts. In his entry, Porsche presented both northern and southern physicians' uses and experiences with basically the blood root. He cites Dr. Bard of New York, who mentions the plant's narcotic value, as well as the tendency to produce vomiting and its usefulness in diseases of the mucosa membranes. Dr. Branch of Abbeville, South Carolina, was cited for his application of blood root to treating croup. Porsche's entries in his report to the American Medical Association reveal three important historical insights into medicine during the 1840s. First, northern and southern physicians were engaged in a dialogue with each other about the benefits of plants and medical uses. Porsche's report in his interest of the head of the American Medical Association and his interest in Porsche's previously published works revealed the interest in indigenous plant knowledge shared between northern and southern physicians. Secondly, medicine had many elements of various other botanical traditions in it. Finally, indigenous knowledge seemed to be important, although not credited, into organizing this system. Medicine, again, the 1840s, was still a morass of practitioners. And Porsche was working to try to bring order and to legitimize what he considered high status medicine by contributing to these societies. So let's look at the book in its volume after the American Civil War it comes a couple of years after the war in 1869. And we're going to look at some reviews to see how it's characterized. And again, I'm kind of running short on time and stuff. If you have questions about seeing the whole paper and stuff, just let me know. I'd be happy to share and talk about that too. An 1865 review of Porsche's book appears in the Philadelphia publication. Again, this section too also talks about how the book that was published during the American Civil War is also received after it as well. The reviewer notes, again, in the American Journal of Pharmacy, which was a national journal, that the purpose of Fourchet's work was to, quote, meet as far as possible the medical wants caused by the rigorous blockade during the last 2 years of the rebellion, end quote. The review then notes that the author advantageously controlled many botanical and medical publications in the United States, basically contributed to many publications in the United States before the Civil War. The criticisms by the reviewer are that the author should have written a smaller, quote unquote, more practical book. The reviewer, however, was impressed by the paper that was printed in a, quote, country with high paper quality, and the book was very rigorous and, quote, a credible specimen of Confederate work, end quote. The reviewer was also interested in accompanying the pamphlet basically titled The Standards Supply Table of Indigenous Remedies for Field Service and in Sick General Hospitals, end quote. In the December 15th, 1871 edition of Nature, the British scientific magazine of record, John R. Jackson, basically authors a review of the 1869 printing, again coming after the Civil War, of Fourchet's resources. Jackson says that though Fourchet's work concentrates on Southern plants, he makes note of the application of Southern plants to other places in the world. He quotes Fourchet as stating, quote, in a grazing country like England, where vast sums are annually expended on foreign oil cake, the gold of pleasures will soon be found an excellent substitute under manufacture, and consequently, a grower should find a good remuneration of cultivating the seed. The oil cake has been found highly nutritious in the fattening of sheep and oxen, as well as containing a great portion of the mucilages and the nitrogenous matter, which combined are very beneficial in developing fat and lean, end quote. Though Jackson admits that the application is problematic because this plant has not escaped the eyes of English agriculturalists before Fourchet's work, it did do a good job in, quote, promoting experiments on their culture and utility. The real importance of the book for Jackson is that, quote, ingenious applications that Fourchet finds for Southern plants. Jackson concludes that, quote, we do not hesitate to say that a few books of his description of economic products of different parts of the globe would make us better acquainted with the true value of the vegetable kingdom than we are at present. In the South, unsurprisingly, the reviews of the book were pretty glowing and stuff. There's several in the Charleston Courier and stuff. They often emphasize how valuable the work both is to the South and potentially to other parts of the country. Another review emphasized in 1869 the utility of domestic remedies. But the thing that's really interesting, if you look at the 1869 edition, you can look at several editions of this book through Google Books, through the project at Michigan, through archive.org and stuff. Also, it's available in several libraries in Greater Philadelphia and stuff I've looked at. It's cool because you see a lot of the interesting kind of changes that Fourchet is seeing and kind of like reconstructing the South in terms of changing its agricultural economy to getting people to sell like herbs and medicines and stuff. A Southern reviewer notes that he's kind of like jealous about Philadelphians that sell herbs and other botanical medicines, like doctors and stuff. And he kind of wants the use of this book basically to help in, kind of like the South to kind of function the same way that the North is. And again, it's pretty clear that people responded pretty positively to Fourchet's 1869 edition in terms of both, kind of regions and areas and stuff. The book's manufactured higher quality and he revises it and stuff. But again, it looks a lot like his dissertation, and it looks like a lot like that report that he gave to the American Medical Association way before the war started. So what I'm trying to kind of get at here to kind of sum it up and stuff is that you can't see it outside of its like crazy, like Confederate nationalistic context, because it's like Fourchet, he's clearly like emotionally invested, politically invested in the Confederacy and stuff. Like he is a Confederate national. Like many historians have talked about the Confederacy having kind of a nationalistic framework, like it thought of itself as like a nation or something like that. you know, my spouse is a Civil War historian too, and she constantly emphasizes that too. You know, so when she teaches her students, it's like you have to see it like a romantic nationalism and stuff. And there's several books, you know, kind of written to that extent. But what I'm trying to say here too is that yes, that is completely true, and it is a world of slavery and white supremacy, and that is also part of this context. But if you also look at it from kind of another aspect, it's an opportunist who is trying to put his kind of medical plant project into these different boxes that he feels like is just useful kind of at the moment and stuff too. So, you know, at the same time, the Confederate nationalistic context is completely valuable in understanding that. And there's been a lot of ink spilled about that. But I think the project about botany is that you see kind of a continuation of a project, and you see kind of the people who are doing it try to reframe it as the, you know, kind of like opportunity. But, you know, we can look kind of cynically at this too, especially at kind of the opportunities kind of come about and stuff too. And I think it's kind of an interesting start of a conversation where we front load kind of all the other scholars of the Civil War and the science studies people, and we have kind of this really kind of interesting, you know, kind of moment to talk about and stuff. So thank you all so much for your time and attention, and I can't wait to talk about this and to address questions. So thanks.
All right, thank you so much for your talk.
Now thank you.
We have you here live to answer questions after your pre-recorded talk. Again, if anyone in the audience has any questions for Alan, you can put them in the chat here on YouTube and we'll see them immediately, or you can send them to lunchtimelectures@sciencehistory.org. I guess I'll start off, you know, thank you so much for such an interesting talk about a really unique work, especially very, very particularly placed in its own context. I'm certainly familiar with, say, 18th century works of botany that are very, very focused on similar issues of, you know, import substitution and, you know, protection of the nascent nation from basically, you know, protecting its access to various plants and animals and just resources in a context in which they could be cut off or which they could be priced out of reach. So I guess I would start by asking in what proportion is this work more of a work of medical advantage or economic advantage? Like, is he really framing it as these are economically advantageous discoveries, or is the advantage primarily that we can cure all of our own illnesses without buying medicines?
Yeah, that's a great question. And I think it speaks to which Porché are you dealing with? Because I think in the 1863 edition, it's very focused on trying to frame, you know, what he's working with for the emergency needs of the Civil War and stuff. Because the, you know, the Confederacy is just woefully, you know, kind of unprepared for the type of medical needs that they're going to have and stuff. And so if you look at the 1863 edition, it's very focused on kind of practical, almost kind of like bedside kind of emergencies. But if you look at the 1869 edition, it really emphasizes how to make things. There's this really great image in there, and I wish I had thought to kind of share it and stuff. Your question made me kind of think about it. There's an advertisement for fertilizer and stuff, and it's very focused on like what kind of things can the South really kind of like rebuild itself to utilize and stuff. How can it kind of change the economy and stuff? I think one of the things that I want to look at when I get kind of further into this work is that how does he kind of change his kind of like pro-slavery ideology to kind of fit the economy and stuff as well. I think that'd be an interesting question. The other thing is that many people at home, you know, we're all sick at home and everybody's been trying to learn how to make like bread, and like, you know, I, as someone who wasn't a cook to start out, you know, the quarantine and stuff. Now I've kind of had to learn how to do it. So I've learned how to like make like Cornish hens, and you know, I love to eat and stuff. And so you can get on Google Books and you can try some of these recipes, and there's these really interesting, I get to teach food history here too at Tech. And one of the things that I get to do is get students to try a recipe. So you can go to the 1869 edition on Google Books and stuff. We can share the link and stuff, and you can try some of these like weird recipes and stuff. One of the things that some of my students have taught me since I teach in rural kind of Appalachia and stuff is dishes with like dandelion root, and kind of like building on kind of like this tradition of kind of like whatever is around. And that's certainly not a culinary tradition that's limited to the South. It's kind of like worldwide and stuff, but you can try some really kind of like far out recipes and stuff. Again, you know, make sure you're consulting with, you know, somebody, you know, that knows a lot more about botany and stuff. But a lot of the recipes, like the cake and stuff that we talked about and stuff, like you can actually make. And you can also, you know, those people who are very creative and stuff, you can kind of add things to it. One of my favorite things to watch on Amazon is Making It Modern and stuff, where a cook takes these like really kind of like disgusting kind of like aspics and stuff that people were really into, you know, in the mid-century kind of time, with like kind of mayonnaise as a key ingredient. You can kind of fix it to our kind of palate and stuff. So you might see some real kind of creative license and stuff to be able to try some of this stuff, whereas Porcher certainly turns to more kind of an economical kind of point of view, because, you know, he's not seeing the, like, you know, devastation and certainly the lack of medical equipment, to say the least, and stuff. My wife, this is a great thing about being married to a Civil War historian, and she also does race and history of medicine. We talk a lot about this stuff kind of over the dinner table, and she's always telling me how, you know, the Confederacy really wasn't just lined up for the needs that they were going to have, because they focused all their economy on cotton and stuff, and not on any of the wartime, you know, materials like food and stuff like that. And so someone like Porcher is trying to kind of like scramble, you know, to kind of transition out of the terror, you know, kind of the poorly managed situation of just a cotton economy, and trying to kind of come up with, okay, well, we can't get bandages, we can't get medicines, here's what you can kind of grab around you or something. And then that's the Porcher and Reconstruction that's trying to kind of focus on building fertilizer, maybe utilizing some of the techniques from abroad and stuff. And certainly, no matter how, what edition you kind of look at this with Porcher, even in his ultra Confederate nationalistic context, he's still not opposed to using information from other regions. And I thought that was kind of the most striking thing to me, even, you know, when I kind of started this work as kind of a graduate student and kind of returning to it, how he has that, you know, kind of ideology, but when the rubber hits the road, he's not, you know, not open to any other, you know, source of information and stuff. And he readily cites it and stuff in there.
It's really interesting. Speaking of being open to other sources of information, I know you talked a little about this in the talk, but I wonder if you could expand some on the idea of who Porcher is acknowledging as experts, who he's getting his information from. I know I've seen over the years some significant work on the kind of independent medical knowledge and theory of enslaved communities, mm-hmm. and indigenous communities in the American South, alongside the kind of white medical knowledge that would have been in contact with Europe and integrated with that culture. I was really curious about how much indigenous and enslaved knowledge that Porcher was able to take, since he's working with these these native plants there in the South.
Yeah, that's a great question. And certainly a book that really kind of like stuck out of my mind that I had to read for comps, and I really dug it and stuff. It's called Working Cures, and it's by I say everyone who has probably done like science and tech or something like that in the U.S. South and stuff. Prey loves that book, and it's fantastic. And certainly, she's an authority on this type of question. So I would point you to that. And Wanda Schiebinger, with her I think she calls it like biospheering or bioprospecting and stuff. Certainly, she works a lot with that, especially in her book about bodies, but also her other book, An Anxious Pursuit. I'd also point people to, in terms of the black rice theory and stuff too, about rice cultivation in the South too. Certainly those are things I'd point you to. In terms of engaging with this question stuff, how much indigenous knowledge did he put into his work and stuff? It's in there, but it's sprinkled in there, but it's certainly not as much as Dr. Solomon or Dr. I would assume would be in there. And it's kind of surprising that it's only kind of sprinkled in. And one of the things is, if you look at the book in kind of a context of professionalizing medicine and stuff, he's got a problem in the sense that he would readily take knowledge from indigenous practitioners, enslaved persons, free people of color. He would take that knowledge, but he's in a tight situation where, as a, you know, medicine is professionalizing in the 19th century. And one of the things that they're trying to do is depending on the account of the professionalization of medicine that you take, like the STARS kind of like sociological kind of approach to that, basically the saying that medicine is professionalizing because doctors are trying to take over the marketplace. And one of the things that's going on here is that they want to basically have a monopoly. And so they're not going to give credit where credit is due because they're worried about their professional status. That might hurt their professional status. Also, too, it's a white supremacist society. So that could also affect Fourche's, you know, he might have taken more information from indigenous practitioners and enslaved persons and free persons of color, but simply didn't choose to acknowledge it and stuff. And in some cases, because, you know, he's a white supremacist, he backs the Confederacy for a reason, you know? So I would be curious, like one of the things I'm really kind of itching to do after the pandemic and stuff is go back to Charleston and do a lot more archival research and see if there's that part of the story that's in there and stuff. Because again, he, you know, indigenous practitioners, you know, according to the historiography and stuff, would know more than Fourche and enslaved persons potentially as well. So again, it'd be an interesting, you know, to kind of put more in that. The other person that he cites, William Gilmore Sims, too, he also sent him information about enslaved persons knowing, you know, basically knowing like kind of an anecdote about a cure and stuff, but it kind of gets kind of lost between the letter and the book and stuff. And Sims is also an apologist for slavery. He is also a white supremacist who writes several kind of like novels and stuff about kind of the grandeur of a slave society. And also he writes against Uncle Tom's Cabin too. So again, there's that's kind of the thing that my wife and I continually kind of talk about, because she does slavery and stuff too. You know, it's like she always emphasizes you gotta, you know, kind of talk about the story of slavery in this, you know, kind of part too. And, you know, us as historians of science, sometimes we're really good at getting kind of the kind of technical knowledge down, but trying to kind of contextualize it in societies and stuff. I think that's a great conversation that we can open up with other historians in other fields and stuff.
So I'm really interested in kind of your general thesis here in your talk today about how this, it definitely does fit into its nationalist context, but also it has this this resistance to being just simply categorized in this Confederate nationalist context. And I am still wondering like how you see this work fitting in, perhaps if it were a northern work or a western work, maybe rather than a southern work. I'm trying to, without being too, you know, counterfactual, get into how would this have been different without its context in the ways that you're saying that it can be viewed differently aside from its context?
Yeah, one of the books that I was kind of like, I think like affected by was Bernath's. There's this really good book. It's called Confederate Minds and Stuff. And it really kind of analyzes works done in the Confederate South exclusively kind of in their nationalistic context. But one of the things that I'm trying to say here, and it's, you know, this is kind of the great thing about giving these brown bag lunches too, is that I get great questions like this. And also it causes me to kind of rethink my approach to work and stuff. Cause one of the things, you know, historians like to do is they try to move things towards publication so everybody can read it and stuff, you know, and kind of interact with it and stuff. The thing that, and it, you know, it's kind of a different thesis. Cause it's like, you know, you could say, you know, on the one hand, you know, you're kind of falling, you know, kind of over yourself to say, you know, look, it does fit in this nationalistic context really well. But one of the things that I think makes it interesting is that if you kind of jump back from the historiography and kind of look at this Fourchet's work, you know, kind of from the long, you know, kind of the big picture and stuff. If you read the stuff that he's working on, a lot of these medical students had to write kind of medical dissertations and stuff in order to get their MD degree and stuff. And so one of the things is when he writes, you know, basically that kind of brief sketch, and he, you know, you kind of look at that, you look at the 1863 edition, you look at the 1869 edition, you're seeing kind of the same botanical project that's just being kind of stuffed into the areas that he needs it to be stuffed into and stuff. And so I think that is something interesting to add to the historiography. I don't want to say, hey, the context doesn't matter. I'm just saying, hey, by the way, if you look at the long botanical project, it's really interesting. For the chemistry people out there, there's a book by Lawrence Principi about alchemy, and he talks about how alchemy doesn't fit nicely into periods and stuff. It kind of, you know, it changes into different projects and stuff, but it never goes away. And I think the botany here looks very much like that, because there are people doing what Fourchet is doing in the South in the 19th century. There's Bartram, there's the Catesby kind of piece and stuff too. He travels around the South and Jamaica and the Caribbean and stuff, and his art is so beautiful. One of the things I would encourage people to do after this talk is to look at some of these digitized botanical sources, because the art is like so beautiful and stuff. So it is just a decadent kind of beauty of it, with all these kind of plates and stuff to look at too. So the University of South Carolina they're one of the few places that has a full Mark Catesby book and stuff. And you can go on their library's website and see the digitized version. And also the Science History Institute also sent out a link, I think, in the chat about to look at the Fourchet Garden and stuff too. And again, just kind of seeing this type of stuff. And the kind of good thing about, you know, if you're around Charleston or something like that, it's certainly socially distanced to kind of go out and look. And also the Waring Medical Library is also something that is a real treat to look at, that people often kind of skip over, you know, kind of on their way to, you know, King Street or something like that, you know, to look at the shops and stuff. My wife and I were able to do research there this past summer before, you know, things changed, and it's really awesome. So again, check out the Medical University of South Carolina. It's a really great place to look at. So again, I'm just trying to say, you know, I think it adds, you know, kind of this kind of bigger picture about what the botanical project's trying to do. And, you know, Fourchet is kind of, you know, he has other interests and stuff too. You know, again, he's got his own kind of agenda and stuff. So he's utilizing that project in different ways and stuff. And I think kind of adding that with the context gives you a richer kind of reading of this really interesting book and stuff.
Right. So we've only got maybe two or three more minutes, so I guess I have just one smaller question for you. Certainly Fourchet sounds like he's really trying to advertise and promote Southern, you know, Southern botanical resources. Do you think he's coming more from a perspective of these are undiscovered, or more of a perspective of these have been con- or in general, they've been considered inferior, but let me show you how they are comparable.
Well, that's a good question. Again, it depends on the Porsche that you ask and stuff. Certainly, there's kind of like this kind of like, you know, if you read between the lines, kind of like, hey, you know, like Southern plants are important, but then in many ways, he's showing how they're only useful based on Northern industrial methods and stuff, which is very interesting. You know, one of the things that, you know, like would have been interesting for him to do, I think, is almost to have made like a cookbook or something like that with this, you know, kind of book and stuff, because he wants it to be very practical and stuff. And if you read the book, it's not like Darwin's like Origin of Species or something like that, where it's like meant to be kind of, you know, like read by the fire or something like that. It's really like a bunch of taxonomical information. And then there's like a paragraph or two by each plant about, okay, well, these are the uses that we know of and stuff, but there's not really kind of like a, you know, this is how you do one thing to the next in order to try to get it usable and stuff, which is also interesting. The other thing too is that if you get your hands on an 1863 copy, and you can go to a lot of libraries and stuff and actually check it out in like rare books rooms and stuff, the paper quality and stuff is really hard. I mean, like it's pretty awful. It's like it was made kind of like last minute and stuff, but that 1869 edition is very much more put together. And he revises it significantly and stuff too. And I think you can kind of compare kind of, you know, how you use things too. There's definitely a little bit more kind of instruction, you know, kind of in that as well. And also too, on the Medical University of South Carolina's website that we sent out and stuff too, not only does it have pictures about the, you know, like how to get to the garden and stuff, but also, It has a digitization of a lot of his papers and stuff. So one of the things that Porsche does too is he writes poems about plants too, which is also, you know, pretty interesting and stuff too. And a lot of those are about literal kind of like regrowth of the South and stuff. Let's see, I've got one here too that I had to kind of cut and stuff. And maybe I have enough time to read it and stuff too. But he writes about kind of the regrowth of the South in this kind of reconstruction kind of moment and stuff. He said, "Your voiceless lips, six flowers, are living preachers, each cup of pulpit, each leaf of book, supplying from my fancy numerous teachers from loneliest nook. Neath cloister boughs, each floral bell that ringeth and tolls its perfume on the passing air, make Sabbath in the fields and ever ringeth a call to prayer, not to the domes where crumbling arch and column attest the feebleness of mortal hand, but to the lane most Catholic and solemn, which God hath planned, to that cathedral as boundless as our wonder, whose quenchless lamps the sun and moon supply, its choir the winds and the wave, its organ thunder, its domes the sky. There midst solitude and shade I wander through the green aisles and stretched upon the sod, awed by the silence, unevenly ponder the ways of God." So he writes a lot about different types of flowers and stuff too. And his poems are really cool. And you can kind of see them in the notes and stuff too. I didn't realize that they had digitized a lot of the stuff. It actually had to go to the South Carolina Historical Society to read and stuff. So it's really cool to, you know, read some poems about flowers and stuff. So again, there's hopefully lots of things here that you can kind of add to your kind of, you know, quarantine or kind of socially distanced kind of life and stuff. And the other thing too is like, it was great to write about flowers being kind of like, you know, kind of stuck at home and stuff too, to kind of, you know, explore that kind of outside part of life as we've been kind of forced to be inside in so many ways. So.
All right. Well, thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you very much. I really appreciate it. You guys are fantastic. And thank you all for logging in. I appreciate it.
All right. Thanks so much, Alan. Mm-hmm. All right. Thank you, everyone out there. Please join us next week at the same time for the fourth talk in our series, when Azel Sanford III will give a talk entitled "Segregated Medicine: How Racial Politics Shaped St. Louis's Healthcare System." That'll be next Wednesday, October 28th at 1:00 Eastern Time. For more from the Science History Institute, including updates on all our virtual programs and events, you can follow us online. We are at SciHistory.org on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. I want to say thank you one more time to Alan. Thank you everyone out there for joining us today. Have a great afternoon, and we will see you next week.